Hello everyone, welcome back for lesson 5 of the course Basics of Deep Learning. So today we will speak about datasets, data loader, and embeddings. So let's start with a small recap of what we did so far. So this is the image of the deep learning pipeline of the first lesson. And now you should be familiar with the right part of this figure, namely how to do the training in order to update the weight of your classifier, how to choose a loss on an optimizer, how to build a basic model, so what we saw are convolutional layer and max pool layer. And today we will concentrate on the left part of the image, namely datasets and data loader. So how to feed your model with, in this case, images of cats and dogs. So here is what we did so far. We saw how to use PyTorch tensors and to do automatic differentiation to compute gradient. Then we had a look at how to do classification with deep learning, how to choose the loss, and what are the different optimizers that are available in PyTorch. And last time, we saw convolutional neural networks, namely, I presented two very important layers, convolutional layers and max pooling layer. So today, we'll see another very important layer called embedding layers. But before that, we will discuss datasets and data loader in a generic way. How to feed your network using the Torch Utils Data library of PyTorch. So for data loading in PyTorch, you need to have two basic blocks. The first one is the dataset. So it's an abstract class in PyTorch, and you can build your own dataset class as soon as you define these two very important methods. The first one is the length of the dataset. So it will return the number of samples in your dataset, number of images, or whatever your dataset is. And the second method is getItem, so that if you are asking dataset of I, like this, of your own dataset, it will return the highest sample in your dataset. Then, for the learning, we want to iterate through the dataset. You will never iterate directly through the dataset because we will need to do at least two things. First, feed the network with batches, not single images. And also, do a shuffling of the dataset in order to be able to do a proper training, where you do not first look at all the images of cats and then all the images of dogs. So in order to deal with these two issues, you need to do it thanks to what is called a data loader in PyTorch. So a data loader is built on top of a dataset, and it allows you to iterate through the dataset. So this is done again in the library torchutils.data, written here. And it will do for you the batching of the data. So you specify a batch size, and then if the batch size is 62, you will have a batch of 62 images fed into your network, 62 by 62. Then it will do the shuffling for the training part, which is very important. And the last thing that we will not discuss because it's a bit more technical, it will load the data in parallel using multiprocessing worker, so that you are sure that the data loader is not the bottleneck for your training loop. Okay, so in the very first lesson, we saw actually a quite complicated example of dataset and data loader. So this is part of the code from the first lesson. And remember that we wanted to classify cats and dogs using pre-trained network and pre-trained network on the ImageNet dataset. So here we build two datasets, one for the train and one for the validation set. And we are using this Torch Vision dataset image folder module, okay, which is described here. So what it does, so I think here it's written data loader, but it's a bit misleading. It's actually building a dataset automatically from your folder where your dataset are stored. So remember that you had to put all the images of dogs in a subfolder called dog, for example, or all the images of cat in another subfolder. So this is what is written here. In the datadir train, you had two folders, one with cats and one with dogs. So what dataset image folder will do for you in this case, it will apply this ImageNet format, the transformation on the raw image. So remember, you need to have images of the same size, 200 by 24 by 200 by 24, transform them into tensor and normalize them in order to feed the statistics of the ImageNet dataset written here. So this is done by the dataset image folder, and then it will automatically compute the number of images in your dataset. So in this case, it was 23,000 images. It will automatically detect the classes. So remember, the code is here. Is it still running? So this is the code for the first lesson dataset. Okay. And so if you are asking data sets train you obtain cats and dogs because these are the two names of the folder. But more importantly, what is dataset train of zero? This should be the first image in my dataset. So let's see. So I'm looking at the train. Okay, so this is a tensor. A tuple actually, where the first component is a tensor and the second one is the label, zero in this case. So if you want to have a look at the image only, you can do this. And you see that it's an image 200 by 24 by 200 by 24 with three channels corresponding to the color. And also you can check that the normalization is well done. You see that you have positive, negative number. This is due to the rescaling, due to the normalization. Okay. So this dataset is now a valid dataset for PyTorch. So you can iterate over it through a data loader. And this is what we did in the first lecture by using torchutildata.dataloader. This is on the train. And here are the important three things. So the batch size, 64. Shuffle equal true because I'm on the training set. And number of workers is what I mentioned if you want to do things in parallel. Then you will iterate over this train loader with the typical training loop. You compute the output of your model, compute the loss, put the gradient to zero, then compute the gradient and do one step of optimization. Okay, so this was the first example where you see the for the dataset we used already something quite elaborated from PyTorch. And then if you remember, we did compute the feature of my images. this was. So remember, this is the VGG, and we computed all the output of this convolutional network in order to speed up the processus. So this is done over here. Config train, labels train. So it's returning a NumPy array of the output of my image in term of features. So now what we wanted to do is to train only the classifier of VGG on these new features. So in order to do that, we had to build a data set, and this is what is done over there. Okay. So you see that I'm constructing a new loader fit train. First, I'm computing a new dataset fit train. So I'm taking, perhaps it's better on the slide because no, because so I'm taking my convolutional feature on my labels, and I'm returning tensor here. That's what I'm doing here. So then you see that there is a second step. I need to reshape my input. So why is that? Let's see. So if it's torch from numpy of conf fit train, let's take the first example. So this corresponds to the first image in my sample. So what is the shape? Ah, okay, so it's 512 by 7 by 7. So remember, when you are dealing with convolution and max pooling, so this is what we are doing here, you are transforming an image in a lower quality images, but you are adding also channels. So you start with three channels corresponding to the colors, and you end up with 512 channels on an image of 7 by 7. But then you want to pass this to a fully connected layer here, so matrix multiplication. So in order to do that, you need to flatten your image. So you will obtain an image which is now flattened, so a vector of size 25,088, which is equal to 512 times 7 times 7. And this is exactly, remember, where is the VGG network? Okay, when you look at the classifier, the size of the input is exactly this one. So now you are good. Okay. So now I have a data set which is just a list of vectors of the right size with the. And so this is a tuple where the first component is a vector of the right size, and the second component is just the class ID. So a list is a perfectly fine data set for PyTorch because it has already a built-in function length and getItem. So in order to build a data loader for that, it's very easy. You just need to use the torch util data loader, your list, batch size, and shuffle equal true. And this is exactly what we did in the practicals, in the first lesson. Here. Okay. So this is a pretty simple way to build a data loader. So today, in the practicals, we will build everything from scratch, basically. So both the data loader by using a list on the dataset, sorry, on the data loader also by using this midi-batch function. So you see that this nice feature of Python allows you not to specify how many arguments this function will take. And in our case, we will need three arguments, basically. And what this is doing, it's returning an iterator where you are sending batches of the appropriate sizes. So here I'm slicing the x for x in tensor between y and y plus batch size. So the mini batch is just doing the batch part, and I need to define another function for the shuffling. So what I will first do is I will shuffle all my dataset and then use the with this function, and then use the mini batch in order to get batch one after the other. And then inside an epoch, what you are doing is, so here you will see that I have three different tensors as input of my network. I'm first shuffling everything, putting everything into a torch tensor on GPU if I have access to a GPU, and then I'm iterating over my dataset thanks to the mini batch here function I just defined over there. So this is a case where I'm not using any PyTorch feature in order to build the data loader. It's completely fine. So if you want to know more about PyTorch data loading, there is a very nice PyTorch tutorial where you see, I mean, sometimes you need labels which are much more elaborate than what we saw so far. And here it is explained how to do such things. Okay, so now you know all the basic blocks that are required in order to do the full training of simple deep learning model. You know how to feed your model, how to build your model, how to choose your loss and optimizer, and how to do the training loop. So in the last part of this video, I want to speak about what to do if you have tabular data as input, and more precisely, if you have symbolic data, like you have a kind of Excel file, and each line is a sample, and on this line you have quantity which are symbolic, like let's say a color. So how do you encode such symbolic data in order to feed your network with this symbolic data? So let's say we have in your tabular dataset one column corresponding to a given colors. So there are four colors: blue, red, orange, and green. What is not appropriate to do is to encode the blue by a 0, the red by a 1, the orange by a 2, and the green by a 3. So why is that? It's because you see that you are assuming that the colors first are ordered. So the 1 is in between 0 and 2. There is a natural order on this number. The distances are not the same. The blue and the red are closer together than the blue and the green, which are things which might be inappropriate for your learning. So you are adding, in a sense, some noise in your training. So one way to deal with this issue is to do what is called one hot encoding. So again, this one hot encoding scheme it's not only relevant for deep learning, it's much broader, and you can apply this to a lot of machine learning tasks. So here is how it works. You have four different colors, so you will encode everything by a vector of size 4, and you will put only one one at in the first position if it's blue, in the second position if it's red, third one if it's orange, and the last one if it's green. So you see that if I'm looking just at the first axis, it's telling me whether it's blue or not, red or not, orange or not, green or not. So you obtain a very sparse representation of your data because you have only one one and all the rest is zero. Now there is no more ordering between these different representation, and also all the symbols are equidistant, so there is no natural, I mean, the distance is the same among all the one-hot encoded representation of your symbolic data. You can check that if the size of this vector, so the number of different categories, is big, then the distance will, the Euclidean distance will be roughly a square root of 2. So it's good if you don't want to make more assumption on your dataset than what is required in order to do the learning. But now you have a very sparse representation of your data. In particular, if you think not anymore about colors but about words, for example. So if you are trying to do a one-hot encoding of a document which is a text, so you will replace each word by a vector of 0 and 1 with a 1 at only one position. So the size of your vector will be the size of the vocabulary in your text, which might be huge. So you will end up with huge vectors where everything, all components are 0 except at one position. So clearly, such sparse and discrete representation will not work in deep learning because, let's say, you are applying a 1D convolution, you will see zeros everywhere, only one one at some point, so the signal will be very weak. So one way to deal with this issue is to do a projection in a what is called a feature space. So what is a projection? It's nothing more than you can see it as a matrix multiplication. So you take the one hot version of your X, let's say it's a color. So this one hot has zeros everywhere except at one position. And the W is a matrix of size n times d, where n is the size of the vocabulary, and d is the size of the feature space you want to project on. So d will be typically much smaller than n, the size of the vocabulary. So this is what we call the embedding of the color X. By just multiplying this vector for the blue color with a matrix W of size, so here there are four colors times d, the dimension you want to you can choose. So typically, what you can do in such a setting is you will take first a random W, so you will take random numbers in W. We will see how to initialize the W properly in the practicals, and then if you are in a supervised setting, so if you do, for example, classification, what you can do is see this W matrix as a parameter of your network and update this parameter thanks to the backpropagation algorithm. So the W will be a trainable parameter of the model, and you will learn a good projection of your categorical input inside your feature space. So now you obtain something which is much better in a deep learning setting, namely the embedding of x is now a vector in RD for a given x, which is continuous on a dense representation. The size of the embedding is completely independent of the size of the vocabulary because you are projecting. But of course, you lost the meaning of each axis. So your hope is that thanks to the training of W, you will be able to keep some semantic meaning in the feature space. So here is one example that we'll do today. So we will build embeddings for movies. So we'll see how. And here is a projection in two dimensions of the embeddings that are found by our algorithm. And you see that, okay, here you have Pulp Fiction, Terminator, The Matrix, Alien, Alien here, Terminator again, Die Hard. So here you have like action movie, quite violent one. And at the bottom you have Babe, When Harry Met Sally, Wizard of Oz. So these are Toy Story 1, Toy Story 2. These are movies for mainly children and with no violence at all. So you can see that you can interpret this direction, the vertical one, as going from movies for a general public with no violence to movies, action movies on the top. Okay? And this representation of the movies is learned by your algorithm, and you will see how. Okay, so one last point. In PyTorch, we never do this matrix multiplication here. This is written like that just to present it in a formal way, but what you are really doing here for the embedding of x is you are selecting only one line in the W matrix. Okay, so this is the way PyTorch is doing that instead of doing the full matrix multiplication. So in order to do that, you can use the sparse layer in PyTorch, the embedding. The documentation is here. So you see it's a simple lookup table, so it's not a matrix multiplication, as I said. And here is one example. So we will do a collaborative filtering task in the practicals where we will build embeddings for what we call user and embedding for movies. So here, I'm building embedding for user using the Torch NN embedding. So you need to specify two things: the number of vector you want to build, so the number of user, and the dimension d. So these are the two n and d parameters over there. So here I'm taking a dimension 3, and the total number of user is the one in my dataset. Now I'm looking at a batch here, input, actually two batches of four different individuals. So the first batch contain the user 1, 2, 4, 5. The second batch contain user 4, 3, 2, 0. So let's see what is the output of this embedding user taken for this input. So you see that each line has size 3 because I'm asking for an embedding of size 3. So this corresponds to the embedding of the first user, the second user, the fourth user, the fifth user, and this is my first batch. This is the second batch, and you see that I'm starting again with this line, which is exactly the same as this one because this is the embedding of user number 4. Okay? Then I have the embedding of user number 3, number 2, which is the same one as this one, and finally number 0. So this is a very simple way to do embedding. And remember, so here I'm starting with random numbers over there. So we'll see how these random numbers are chosen. And then, when you are building your network, you will put this embedding in the init method of your network, so that this parameter will be learned as you learn the task. So, namely, in this case, for collaborative filtering. So, in order to be a bit more explicit, we can move on to the second video and have a look at the practicals that I will describe to you.